thank you, God, for freedom today. Thank you, Lord, for completion of the cross, oh Lord. We worship you, God, in this house today. We honor you, God. Hallelujah. We thank you, God, for everything. Freedom today. God, freedom from those things, oh God, that are trying to hold us captive, oh God. But God, praise the Lord, oh God, we are free, oh God. The prison doors are open, oh God, today, oh God. Hallelujah. Help us to see us, oh Lord, as you see us, oh God. Hallelujah. God, we are rich, oh God, and truly favored, oh God, today, oh God. We are blessed, oh God. Hallelujah. We are victorious, oh God. God, we are a people of hope, oh God, and expectation, oh God. God, that we are a people of health, oh God, today, oh God. Lord, we praise you, God. We lift your hand. We lift you up, oh God, in this house, oh God. Help us to see, oh God, as we need to see, oh God, today. Help us to see us, God, as you see us, oh God, today.
Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. Oh, my God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. I'm the sea of victory. I'm the sea of victory. Oh, the battle belongs to you, Lord.
God kept taking us through, me and my family. Hallelujah, we are not done yet, but he continues to walk through us. But praise God, today he has victory over his life. I don't know what you're fighting this morning. I don't know if it's mental, if it's emotional, or if it's physical, if it's financial, if it's a relationship, if it is your job, but it is not your battle this morning. Give it to him. Proclaim the victory. Allow him to see you victorious in this moment. Hallelujah. Be strong and be courageous. Keep walking. Hallelujah. Keep praising. Keep worshiping. Keep meditating on him. Keep your eyes on him. Because he wants you to see something. He wants you to be a winner. Hallelujah. You are victorious this morning. I want you to take that with you out of this house today. You are victorious this morning. What the enemy meant to take you out. Hallelujah. God is going to bring goodness and strength into you today. Hallelujah.
You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good.
I don't even really want you to shake hands or hug, but We'll give you 30 seconds, a couple fist bumps. If the germ phobia people are here, we've got some hand sanitizer. But 30 seconds, greet one another. Tammy gave a testimony. Clark had surgery just a couple of weeks ago. He's, you know, progressing, so praise God. Look, I'm just going to say something. If you're going to clap, let's do it. You know, if you're going to clap, do it right. We got JR over here, had surgery this week, and, but he's doing progressing good. We talked a little bit yesterday, so hallelujah, right? Praise God. I'll throw this out. We do believe that God still does instantaneous miracles. Yay. But we also praise God for our modern medicine, how he has gifted mankind in the ingenuities in medicine. So praise God. Got two families that's kind of connected to us in a time of bereavement. Most of you know Ira Byron Parker passed away recently. That funeral will be or this coming Saturday. Many would know Teeny Man Munns. He passed away, connected certainly with our church family here. So please pray for that family in the time of bereavement. Ramona Jones, she's had some heart issues. Actually, Phil also recently, and just so many. And we could go down the list of the ones who are sick and out today with colds and flu and that sort of thing. So if we can, we serve a mighty risen Savior. We were just talking recently, this morning, we were talking about the Messiah and the Anointed One and really the description and the definition of all that. We went back to Isaiah chapter 61 and also over where Christ quotes the same scripture out of Isaiah 61. And he says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me." And he goes down this long list of things that the reason he can't. And the reason he came 2,000 years ago is still true and viable and precious and receivable today. So whatever's going through your mind, whether Tammy went through a list of things and possibilities, but you know what your needs are, right? You know the people around you, and God knows too. I'm just going to ask if we can just come together in a time of agreement. Of prayer. So normally whoever is doing the opening, we call on somebody. I'm just going to ask that with you. I'm going to leave. I'm going to ask all of you guys to participate with me. Is that okay? It's not going to confuse God. if you pray at the same time I do, he's going to hear our prayers. Amen? Let's pray together. Many needs, and I certainly didn't mention them all, but let's pray. Mighty God, we give you praise, and the scripture says to enter your gates with thanksgiving and into your courts with praise. So God, we have tried to do that. We've uplifted the name above every name through our song. Some have lifted our hands up to you. Some have kind of given a soft shout, Father. And God, we come corporately lifting that name up. Father, we know that we can only approach you through the mighty name of Jesus. And that's how we only yet boldly come to the throne room today. Father, we mentioned several praise reports in here today. And so, Father, we thank you. We thank you, Father. We thank you for success. We thank you for victory. Not that we have to get to victory, but the victory is ours already through Jesus Christ. Father, I pray for, this is just such a long list that goes through my mind. Father, I pray for the ones that are in bereavement. Father, we ask that you would send ministering angels to them. I ask that you would send the Holy Spirit to comfort and to keep and protect and to harness them up, bolster them up in their faith, God. And I pray that those families that are in bereavement today, there's families around there that are people that don't know you. Father, I ask that through a word or a hug or tears shed or story, Father, I ask that you would step in the middle of it. And Father, I ask that the people would be redeemed by the mighty, precious, powerful name of Jesus. Father, we ask for I'll just pray for the region. Father, there's just so much sickness, flu, and colds. And so, Father, we ask that you would just touch these families. God, I ask for the moms and dads, well, the real small ones, and it's a struggle for them to see their little one, maybe for the first time, seeing their little one just so sick. So God, I ask that you comfort the parents as well during this winter months. So Father, we've come to bless your name. We've come to lift high your name. We've come to fellowship with one another. We've come to community together. Father, we've come to hear your word. So God, we pray over Johnny as he will be bringing the message today. God, I ask that you would speak through him. God, I ask that you would anoint his mouth. I ask that you would anoint our ears to hear what the Spirit would say to each one of us. God, we know we're not here. None of us are here just by happenstance. But we're here in the divine will of God. So God, we bless your mighty name. We bless your mighty name today. Amen. I'm going to ask if the ushers would come at this time. Got two things I want to say. Guys, I may have mentioned it last week, but last month, it was what Patrick said it was. Just hold on 1 second. Thank you, guys. Can we give these two guys so faithful to us? I think Patrick told me last month, December, was, if it wasn't the, it's in the very top of the all-time giving since he's been the treasurer of our church. So praise God. Thank you guys for, I just heard it. You can't outgive a king. You can't outgive a king. So thank you for your generosity. This is another announcement I wanted to make. The leadership team last month we met, and they have gone and given a go-ahead to do our foyer area. They're contacting, we're trying to get on the list of the contractors now. They've given me through March to try to raise the rest of the funds. We're about two-thirds of the way there. So we need about 10 more thousand or so. And they just challenged me, but we've got a green light from them. So the ones that's in here, thank you guys. I think a facelift to our foyer is going to be beautiful. And there's many people that are looking to come through those doors. I know there's a harvest, not just for this house, but there's a harvest of souls for this region. I'm praying for the harvest. Are we praying for the Lord, to the Lord the harvest? So I'm going to ask these guys if they would receive your tithing and your offering. Thank you as you give. Bless you as you give. Thank you.
their lives look back at a fork in the road where they headed toward isolation and a loss of hope.
The last two generations of him, there have been 25 marriages and 22 divorces.
And what does it do to children when they see the image of that being ripped apart? What the cross promises in marriage is fresh starts and new beginnings.
What it was a trailer for our upcoming Art of Marriage Live. It's going to be February the 21st and 22nd. I think today or tomorrow everything will be up online for registration. It's open to anyone. I was talking to Keith and Trish Tully. Will be with us from Arkansas. It's $20 per person, and that will cover it'll cover registration and also cover after the workshop. It'll have materials that'll be provided as well. So it'll begin on Friday, on the 21st of February, and it will roll into Saturday the 22nd. And you'll be able to see that online, and we'll push that out on Facebook either today or tomorrow. It's for the happily married people. It's for those who may be just been married, or maybe you're getting ready to get married. It may be for the ones that are really, really struggling. And it's so, if I was talking to Keith last night, he said, make sure I share this. It's also for the ones who have been married and divorced and still having some hurt from, some residual hurt from that. So it's open. February the 21st, 22nd, go ahead and put it down on your iPhones. So at this time, I'm going to ask Johnny to come up, and can we give Elder Johnny Byram a hand clap as he comes to minister to us? Last Sunday, we had a good time, right?
Yeah.
did. A little extended worship, a little longer than normal, and Pastor Walter did not get to his main points. He rehearsed basically what I just got over, right? And the last two Sundays, what we were planning on talking about was things that we need to cut loose, things that we need to let go of in the year 2020. And how many in here set any goals at the first of the year, made any New Year's resolutions? Anybody? Okay. Anybody still keeping those resolutions? Okay. See, most of us, we make, when the new year comes in, we make resolutions, and then before we know it, we're doing what? We done took them back, right? And I'm going to go ahead and give him his duty, because I was hoping he was going to go ahead and do it today.
But that would take your time. That would take your time. I thought about it.
One of his was doubt. He was going to talk about doubt. Another thing he was going to talk about was we don't need to quit. We don't need to give up. And then this one, we need to stop doing this. We need to let go of it. So we're going to talk about some things this morning that we need to let go of. If I titled this message this morning or whatever, it would be Living by God's Design. And all of us want to do that, right? If we don't, something is wrong with us. But we've been talking about, when we read out of chapter 27 of Acts, we've been talking about a ship. And that ship was what? Tempest tossed. The 4 points come where from where they said they dropped 4 anchors to do what? To stabilize the ship. Okay. And I want to talk about this morning the little difference between us and what a ship is. Okay. A ship's made to do what? It's do what?
Sail.
It's made to sail. A ship is made to carry weight, right? That this ship that we've been talking about the first two Sundays was loaded not only with people, but it was loaded with cargo. It had wheat on it, and it was probably sailing to a place to unload that wheat, okay? And the difference between a ship and us is a ship was made to carry weight. We aren't. I got a book bag full of weight, and my intention was to keep it on till I got to a certain point. But my wife told me, don't tell her she's right. She told me it was a little bit too heavy. But let's go. I'm going to read three verses out of 27 right now, and then we're going to, let me see where I'm at. And Walton's already read these. And because we were exceedingly tempest-tossed, the next day they lightened the ship, okay? And then the next verse said, verse 19, and on the third day we threw the ship's tackle overboard with our own hands, okay? And then in 38, it says, and so when they had eaten enough, they lightened the ship and threw out the wheat into the sea. So 3 times in this one scripture, they did what? They threw things off. They lightened the load that they were carrying. Okay? And see, we won't, like I've already said, we are not designed to carry weight. That's the difference between us and a ship. A ship, anybody know what this is right here? That's a ding, 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 ding. No. Anybody know what kind of rock this is?
Ballast.
A what?
Ballast.
A ballast. Okay. Anybody know what a ballast rock is? Okay, a ballast rock is a rock that they put into ships before they were made out of metal to stabilize a ship. That rock right there came from the Pequimans River. Right down the road before you get to Charles Layton's, they dug right there by the water, and I found three or four ballast rocks. One of them's twice as big as that one. That one weighs 38 pounds. But what they did, they put these things in ships to lower the center of gravity so the wind and the storm would not turn the ship over. And then when they got to the port, they would unload these rocks and throw them overboard, and then they would put the cargo on, which again would stabilize the ship. These ships were oftentimes in storms in the sea. And Walter was talking about being anchored because storms are coming, right? Storms that we are not sometimes prepared for. Sometimes we know they're coming. But most of the time, storms catch us off guard, right? And when we're caught off guard by guard down, sometimes it's not the best it can be. So we are different from a ship. It says here, so what are we designed for? If a ship is designed to carry a load, if we're talking about us, what do you think you're designed for? Anybody got any idea? Do what?
Carry the gospel.
Carry the gospel? That's one of them. I wrote a few things down, and we're not going to spend a whole lot of time here. But we're designed, we just sung a song right there, we're designed to walk in victory.
Right.
Yeah. That's what we are designed for. But truth be known, sometimes we don't walk in victory, right? But here's some things I wrote down. Walter, Pastor Walter read out of Psalms 139. It talks about we're designed, we're wonderfully made, we're fearfully and wonderfully made, we're skillfully made, and God has written a plan, a book, about the plans and purposes that He has for us, right? Here's some things that we're designed for. We're designed to carry God's anointing as a child of God. We're designed to make a difference in this world. We're designed to be guided by the Holy Spirit. Ephesians 4:12 tells us that we're designed for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. That's what we're designed for. We're designed Amen. To carry the gospel forward.
Amen.
We're designed to reap the harvest. The Bible says that the harvest is plentiful, that we are to pray for harvesters to go into the harvest, right? So that's some of the things that we're designed for. 1 Peter 4:10 tells us that as each one has received a gift, we are to minister it to one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Did you know you got a gift? He says right here, well, I know so-and-so's got a gift, but that's not what Peter said. Peter says, each one of you Amen. Has a gift.
Right.
And why do you have a gift? What's a gift for? It's to give away. It's to help somebody else out. So, one of your purposes is to find out what your gift is. 1 Timothy 1:6 says, therefore I remind you to stir up the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of hands. So, once the gift's yours, what's the responsibility? It's not to sit on the seat, right? But it's to stir it up.
Yeah.
It's to try to get everything that's in that gift out of you to help somebody else. That's what it's for. So, those of us that are in the kingdom of God, and I hope all of us in here are in the kingdom of God. If you are a child of God, You are in the kingdom of God. Now there's more, there's some at the elementary level, some at the mid level, and some at the deeper level. And all of us should be doing what? Growing. But all of us who are in the kingdom of God, we have the ability to help to transform other people. And because we have that ability, the enemy is going to do anything he can to hinder us from being a help to anyone. And how does he hinder us? When Walter was asked me, would I take this Sunday, and if I apologize if you come today wanting to listen to him, I apologize, because I would rather listen to him too. But we're not designed to carry extra weight around. And part of that can be our physical temple. I know that's not a place that we want to hear about, but we are the temple of God, right? And if all of us would be honest, my frame here, I weigh basically 248 pounds. My frame is not built for 248 pounds, right? And I'll leave it right there. I go wash dishes for at my house, and I don't have to wash many dishes before what? My back's already hurting, right? I'm not designed for that. And I'm going to leave that right there. So no more about that. But Luke 21:34 says, "But take heed to yourselves, lest your hearts be weighed down with carousing and drunkenness and the cares of this life, and the day comes to you unexpectedly." If I ask for a show of hands, everybody in here, when the trump sounds, if we're still living, we want to be caught up, right? And if you don't want to be caught up, we'll have a talk out of church. But he's coming back, people. The day of his coming is closer than we can imagine. But see, these things that weigh us down, my mind went to Hebrews 12:1. It says, "Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and sin which so easily ensnares us." We're running a race. But see, there's some things in our life that we tote around that we need not tote around. And the list is big. I've already showed you three right there, right? Things that weigh us down. This scripture here says, every weight. Now that weight might not be a sin, but it still hinders us. It still stops us from accomplishing what we are called to do. And then it says, and sin which so easily ensnares us. And who's he talking to? He's talking to Christians that have these things in their life, and it's hindering them. What's it hindering them from? It's hindering them from being what they're designed to be. That's a priest. That we carry the anointing, that we help carry the burden of our fellow persons. So I've got some right here. And you say, well, that don't none of these affect me. And if they don't, I got the wrong one over here. Hold on. Can you work this book back? My wife wants to put that in there. I put it in there because I knew that would get a laugh.
That's a temptation.
Throw that off the boat.
So here's one weight that we can be carrying around. And my donuts have done messed it up. Can anybody read that? It says unforgiveness. What does that mean? I done got way ahead of myself. We're going to leave that right there. Then we'll come back to it. But see, a weight is anything that hinders us. It's a mass, it's a heaviness, it's a fullness, it's a burden. It's a distraction. And see, we need to know what our weights are. Weights are cumbersome. That's why I didn't keep that book bag on. If I'd have left that big stone out, I could have done it. But you got to ask yourself the question, what's hindering you? What weights are you carrying? See, your weights might not be the same weights that I carry. See, I stand before you today, I'm not perfect. I got things in my life that hinder me, that keep me from being all that I can be. And you say, well, why don't you get rid of them? I tried. But it's just like a New Year's resolution. See, we know things that we need to lay down. And we will for a time, but if we're not careful, what do? We keep them close enough that we can pull them back at any time. That's not what needs to happen. We need to cut things off our life that are hindering us. And the harvest that's out there, that's why we need to cut it off. I want to get to heaven, but I want to carry some people with me.
Right.
And if, as long as I'm hindered, guess what? Somebody else is suffering the consequences of me not doing what I'm called to do, what I'm designed to do. See, some weights are embedded in us. Some weights, we prayed some more. God, take them away, and guess what? We still tote them around. We still got them on our back strap. But see, some weights, God's not going to take away. You're going to have to give them up. Just as these people in this story, out of Acts 27, what did they do? They threw it off with their own hand.
That's right.
I'm not saying we do it all because we can't do it all. But there's some things, some choices that we make. The only way that we're going to get victory over them is do what? We're going to have to do it. And then God's going to help us.
Amen.
That first rock right here is unforgiveness. And this is the weight that people, if they're not careful, they'll carry around their whole life. And this, and the reason that's the biggest rock, that's a serious rock right there. And here's how serious it is. Matthew 6, 14 and 15 says, "For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. And all of us say,
Amen.
Because when we screw up, what do we want God to do? To forgive us. But see, the next verse says, but if you do not forgive men their trespasses,
come on.
Neither will your Father forgive you of your trespasses. That's a big weight to take around. And there are people all over planet Earth that are doing what? Walking around in unforgiveness. I don't need to say any more about that. Misplaced affections. Let me see if I can find out. Misplaced affections. What is that, Johnny? 1 John 2:15 says, do not love the world or the things of the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. So you have to understand what is behind the world. It's the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life. It's the basic of all sin. Genesis 3:6 says, when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, it was pleasant to the eye, a tree desirable to make you wise, what did she do? She took of it. And because she took of it, we're where we're at today. Another one we need to get rid of. Destructive habits. I'm not going to say what your habit is or what my habit is, but sometimes a habit is what? It's destructive, right? It can be a whole lot of things. I can be addicted to this thing right here, right? I can be addicted to the television screen. I can be addicted to watching Andy Griffin, and there's nothing wrong with watching Andy Griffin. Harry's laughing. I'm not talking about you, Harry. Nothing wrong with these things. Addicted to a video game. But habits. And here's my final weight right here. Addictions. And when we think about addictions, what do we think about?
Drugs.
We think about drugs, right? Maybe alcohol. But there's a whole lot of people addicted to a whole lot of things. We can call people come to our mind that's addicted right now to substance abuse. And that's what we think of. And they tried, I promise you, if they could walk away, what would they do? They would walk away. People addicted to lust of the eye. And we could open a whole can of worms then. I'm just going to let you. But see, that's not all. I could put some more stuff in that bag. I wrote down fear. Wrong choices, grudges, conflicts, stress, anxiety, and the list could go on and on and on.
Better be my funny. Keep up with that.
But I read a story the other day. That back in 1845, and that's not a lot, that was before any of our days, there was an ill-fated Franklin expedition sailed from England to find a passage across the Arctic Ocean. And this Lord
Franklin. This was his third trip to try to find a passage through the Arctic Ocean. And the crew took two ships, and they loaded it with food, other needed things, and maybe some things that they did not need. They were just trying to find a passage now. They carried 1,200 volume Ladbury. They had fine china, crystal goblets, sterling silverware with officers' initials engraved in the handles. And the story goes that the ship became trapped in the frozen ice of the Arctic, looking for that passage. And after the food rations began to wear off, about 2 years later, they began to leave the ship in small groups at the time. 129 people left England. All 129 perished. The story goes that two of the officers pulled a sled 65 miles across the ice, trying to find help. But said in that sled that they were pulling was loaded with the silverware. They had their initials on it. Weight that they did not need. And it cost them their life. None of them survived. So here we are today. We're not designed for this, but I know who is designed to carry our weight. 1 Peter 5:7 says that we cast all our cares upon him, for he cares for us. And then Matthew 28:30 says, Jesus says to take my yoke upon you, right? Because it's easy. And if you do that, you find rest. And a yoke is what? A yoke is where you tie two oxen together where one don't pull all the weight. I pulled some things before, some animals out of the woods, dead animals, with other people that I didn't think they were pulling anything. I turn around and look, you sure you're pulling anything? And I'm sure some have pulled me, wanting to know if I pulled anything. But see, when we yoke with Jesus, guess what? He's doing the pulling. He's doing the heavy lifting. It ain't us. It says that we are to cast our cares on him before, because he cares for us. See, Jesus took carrying extra weight seriously. Matthew 5:27-30, we won't read it. It says, if your right eye causes you to sin, what do? You pluck it out. If your right hand causes you to sin, what are you supposed to do? Now, I don't think he's literally telling us to pluck our eye out or cut our arm off. I don't think that's what he's saying. Whatever's causing you hindrance, get rid of it. Lay it aside. So we're at the end here. We're at 12:04. And I'm going to pack my bag back up. Give me a minute. I'm going to put my donuts in last so I will not crush them so I can eat them later. I'm going to ask Pastor to come here and move this ballast rock and this table. I'm asking Johnny to go ahead and play some music. The reason I put these weights back on is because of what I'm getting ready to do.
We know what's hindering us. Everybody agree with me? Well, what you hear this morning and what you've heard this morning is nothing new. It's not earth-shattering. But there's some things that you that are here need to let go of. There's some things that I need to let go of. I'm going to get ready to dismiss. And I'm going to walk out the door. I don't care. The same weight out that I brought in. And if we're not careful, that's what we do every time we hear the Word of God. We come. We know there's things that we need to let go of. Weights and hindrances and outright sin in our life. And we walk out the door the same way that we came in. Like I said, I'm through. But this altar's open. There's people that need to find their way down here. Now, when I walk out the door, because I'm just doing it as an object lesson, I'm going to come back in. Because there's some things that I need to take care of. I'm not throwing a stone. But people, I want to make it. And I want to shed everything that's going to keep me from making it. And you should too. But it's just like that New Year's resolution. If you're not careful, you pull it back. And all these things that I took out of my backpack, what did I do? I put them all back in. The altar's open. God bless you. Thank you. seriously. Don't just push it off. Today may be a defining moment in your life if you'll let Him do it. God bless you.